Are we turning to gambling as a quick fix? England legend Peter Shilton, regarded as one of the greatest goalkeepers of all time, kept a dark secret for much of his life, a chronic gambling addiction. England's most capped player, Peter Shilton, had the world in the palm of his hands. A glittering club career spanning three decades, representing some of Britain's biggest sides at the time, winning two European Cups, a UEFA Super Cup and a First Division Championship. Shilton represented England at three World Cups, less said about some than others. But Shilton was a household name, both home and abroad. But behind the fame and the accolades, Shilton was living with a crippling addiction. Throughout his playing career, he was living a double life as a gambling addict, one that nearly ruined him, not only financially, but mentally and physically. Peter Shilton joins me now. Peter, delighted to have you on the show. Thank you. How much have you lost from gambling?
I would say it was over 45 years, but I would say it was into millions, really. I started out, I had a real passion for horse racing. That was my thing. I didn't really, you know, in those days when I started, there was no slot machines and that type of thing. Yeah, it started out as a hobby and just gradually got more and more. I owned horses. I loved going up the gallops. I loved going to trainers, stables and that type of thing. But then the gambling side just accelerated, and obviously I didn't realise, because money fuels gambling, and when you're earning decent money, not like they earn these days, but, you know that there's plenty of money coming in, and that's the thing that keeps you going, really.
Somebody once said to me about gambling, and I had a period early on in my life, that you lie to yourself, you lie to everybody around you, you make excuses, you believe that, you know, that one big win is round the corner. Did you hide it from your wife, Steph, who, by the way, you now credit with helping you end this 45-year addiction? Do you remember that moment, though, when you had to admit to her that so much had been lies and that you were really in the mire?
Yeah, I mean, I'd met Steph and, you know, I think we knew very quickly that we were made for each other. You know, I was going through a divorce at the time. And to be fair, you know, we just literally sort of... I think Steph knew there was something not right, you know, because gamblers, you just touched on it, we're very secretive. Mm-hmm. You know, you can keep secrets, you can... from anybody, you know.
If you can lie to yourself, you can lie
exactly,
to those you love,
yeah.
Right?
And she knew there was a problem. She'd been in the NHS and she started working on me a little bit, you know, in terms of trying to make me realise, you know, that what I was doing wasn't right. And it eventually paid off. There was a moment when I'd had a particularly bad weekend and I went upstairs and I was phoning an agent that I'd done a job for and just basically saying, can you pay me a bit early? I'll give you a drink. And I looked around and Steph was behind me. And I just knew in her face that, you know, she'd sort of caught me, really.
Did you break down?
Yeah, we did. Yeah, I finally said, look, I've got to stop. You know, I know I've got to stop and I don't want to lose you. And that was... She always said, look, I would never have left you, but she did make a few, you know... things where she made me feel as though she might be leaving, and that was the big thing. And also we wanted to get married, and she says we can't get married until we sort out, you know, the money side of things and the security side of things.
She talked to my team about the shock of seeing a bank statement showing you lost 18 grand in 1 month, and how she revealed on one occasion she found you in the middle of a night in Australia in a hotel having an online bet. So there was a lot of duplicity.
Well, I was at home looking at the Australian
There was a
racing.
Lot of duplicity,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, definitely. I mean, the thing is, you know, once I finished playing football, you know, and the online started, it even accelerated even more.
Does when she trust you now, Pete?
Oh, it was 7.5 years ago when I finished. And I knew myself. You know, I had an unbelievable amount of effort from Steph, you know, to make me stop. But I knew myself at the time that...
Why? What was the moment? Why did you know after 45 years of gambling and wanting to get that rush, get that thrill? Why did you know so?
Because I think I'd had enough of losing. She used to come in and say, it's the losing racing post, you know, and oh, yeah, I bet you've lost again today. And I kept thinking to myself, well, I used to win at everything in football, you know, in my career.
Well, yeah. when you look at that, the most decorated goalkeeper ever, really, the most extraordinary, apart from that cheating thing. but when you look at your career and the adulation that so many felt, do you feel that you sullied that by the gambling? Do you feel...
No, because I didn't have to come out and, you know, and sort
did it affect your game at all?
No, he never... I had two careers. One was football. Nothing ever affected football. I mean, it was my love. It was a, you know, a job I was made to do. And, I when I was away from football, you know, then I'd sit and in between matches and gamble. And it just gradually got more and more and more.
I was going to talk to you about that. I mean, there's a part of me that thinks that football should be doing a lot more to stop a generation of gamblers and drinkers because, you know, they train for a couple of hours in the morning, these kids, they're on £200,000 a week. They're going to get into trouble. Do clubs need to do more, do you think?
Oh, I think so, definitely. I mean, it's rife in football now. You know, it's made for... In sport, generally, you know, it's when you're competing and then you have a period of, you know, having to recover and what have you. It's made for, you know, keeping on a high and gambling and yeah, you know, it's rife, definitely rife now. And the thing is, when you're earning money, people can keep it secret.
But somebody said to me, and I didn't know this until earlier, nearly half of Premier League teams are sponsored by betting companies last season, including Newcastle United and my team, West Ham. What does that do if you've got players struggling with those sorts of addictions? That sends a powerful message, doesn't it?
Yeah, definitely. I mean, the gambling companies, you know, have had carte blanche, really, since 2005 with, you know, with improved profits. They've just been able to do what they want. You know, they're setting up different advertising things. My big thing is shirt sponsorship in football and, you know, around the grounds, because I think football's got a very unhealthy association with gambling, considering it's a family game and it's the beautiful game. And football needs to put its house in order. But I think, you know, generally that a lot needs doing. The government of delaying a white paper should have been out in December.
Your wife, Steph's working with the government.
Yeah, we're doing it together. I mean, the reason I came out was because I spoke to a charity called Gambling With Lives. It was run by people who lost loved ones, mid-20s, through committing suicide from gambling, feeling they couldn't stop. That was the main reason. And I felt that if I came out and I said, look, you know, you can stop, it's not easy, but if you do certain things, and that's what my reason for coming out. And I think obviously Steph is got a very caring side, and he's very good at you know, understanding people around a gambler.
We're looking at Steph now. You say she saved you. I mean, everybody will say that there comes a moment in a gambler's life when you realise, and there was something very personal to you two that clicked it, wasn't it?
Yeah, I think you need a reason to stop, you know, and. You know, Steph was definitely my reason. I think I just got to an age as well where I've just fed up of, you know, sort of living the life I was. Because when you're gambling, it's not just money that you're gambling with, it's time. You know, you spend all day long gambling and end up losing, and it's been a waste of time.
I must move on very briefly. I wish I had far more time. Sky Sports pundit Graeme Souness says he doesn't regret describing football as a man's game after Chelsea's rather dramatic draw with Tottenham yesterday. I think we've got this. Just have a quick look.
All played the game. When you see simulation, people throw themselves to the ground. I've not seen that in the two games today. It's a man's game all of a sudden again. And the referee, I thought, had a fabulous game, other than something we'll point out later. But I thoroughly enjoyed both games today. That, OK, you know, if there is such a thing as a purist who watches football, might get a wee bit excited themselves when the two managers are getting upset with each other. But I'm sorry, it's professional sport. That's what it's all about. You want to win so much. Sometimes you can let go of your emotions and embarrass yourself.
Unrepentant later on TalkSport. Your thoughts on that? I know it's a difficult subject.
Yeah, it is in a sense, but I think Graham was saying really football used to be a bit more physical. People didn't roll over quite so much when they got kicked. And
well, can I jump in and say the Lionesses who won the European Championships, when they get kicked up, they just got straight back up again. They didn't squeal
well, exactly,
like men.
Exactly. And
was
you know,
he being misogynistic? That's what he's been slaughtered
today. I don't think
today.
So. I think he was just saying that, you know, football was a bit more of a man's game, the men's football in the past. But, you know, the Lionesses have done fantastic. They're you know, in football, that's their place. You know, they've won the Euros. I mean,
amazing.
And they show...
More than the men's team who won,
yeah,
they won nothing.
The two are separate, but we're all England, and the fans showed that. The celebration for the ladies, for the girls, was just as much as... for the men.
Peter Shilton, you've been a hero of mine for a long time. I'm going to ask one final question very quick. It's a one-word answer. Best player you ever played against?
He was a cheat, but Maradona.
Oh, you got it. Thank you, Peter Shilton. Now, for viewers who need advice on any of the issues raised just then, helpline information is available at talk.tv/helplines.